You know, it is in this kind of meetings when some of us recover at least a smile, no? At least a smile. We are going through very difficult times in Europe as a general. And, going into these difficult times is nothing strange. The economy is cyclical. And it is the part of the a very unique transformation process which, taking place in a country like Europe, has consequences. And you can feel these consequences all around the world. But it is time for us, it is time for Europeans to go into this economic crisis and make sure that we Europeans realize that what is happening to us is not happening to the rest of the world, because there is a kind of heritage which is cultural, by which we tend to, may I say in English, extrapolate. No? So we are having tough times in Europe, all the world is a disaster. Well, this is not like this. This is not like this. And this is something which must be taken very much into account, because numbers, figures, what tell us is that the world is not doing so bad. We will make sure this year that the world will grow, and will grow at an average of 4%. And all the serious indications we have at the present moment are that the world will continue to grow next year at a path of 4%. So, what the hell is happening? What happens is something which is very interesting and which makes a lot of sense. Finally, there are some other people in other parts of the world which are gaining the race at this particular moment in terms of growth. And as there is no capacity for everybody, others, like us, the Europeans, are falling apart, not in pieces or shrinking, as they say, not so much, and for the time being. But it is okay. If Africa or Asia or India or Latin America have to grow and grow nicely and much, much better than us, that is okay for all of us. Of course, this is a new situation, and it puts some very serious questions, extremely serious questions, on how to manage this new panorama of having one part of the population growing, the other part, which in terms of solvency, liquidity, consumption, etc., not doing so, and how this is going to hamper equilibriums which we had obtained in the past, and very especially, I would say, an ethic discussion on if this is going to be so. In terms of ethics, how sustainable is growth? So, the distance in between some of the areas where the world is growing today and others which we could consider economically mature with, I would say, more than reasonable standard of living, even in terms of social reforms, etc., is the growth which is needed to make it more even sustainable for the world? And if it is not, and it is not, I think it is sustainable. If it is not, then what solution can we bring in into the situation? So, times of changes. We could spend hours and hours and hours talking on the economic situation, but perhaps, and this is just an introduction, because I'm pleased to talk to you about leadership, which is much more interesting and is part of the solution. But may I bring into the table also the fact that we all must consider and be very conscious of the scenario where we are. Why are we in this situation, and how this situation is affecting each of us? And it is my personal opinion, it's very, very personal opinion, is that all this story, which worries us, all this story, began probably at the end of the 90s, at the end of the 90s, we were able to agree in between all of us that the technological revolution, which has been a technological revolution, had introduced at world level a factory. The world had to be a factory, a new factory, which is extraordinarily efficient. And this factory, which has been performing and producing for the last, let me say, 2 decades, this factory, much more efficient, and I insist is due to the technological revolution, has had some side effects. Two very important side effects are financial effects, economic effects. One is a gorgeous liquidity bubble, and the other one, a gorgeous, tremendous real estate bubble. And both of them in the States, because it is the fabric, the factory of the world, is located in the States. So this is where the jump in terms of productivity has been more intense. And these gains in productivity, by the means of the technological revolution, have changed the rules of the game. And the side effects have provoked, I insist, a bubble in terms of real estate and liquidity, which was applied fundamentally to the stock exchange. There is another side effect. And the other side effect, which has been provoked, is unemployment. Having a factory in the world, which is much more efficient, means that to produce the same, or more of the same, or 20% more of the same, or 100% more of the same, or 200% more of the same, can be done not with the same people that used to be employed 10 years ago or 20 years ago, but half of the people that were employed 2 decades ago. And this is an incredible, incredible, very intense change that you can notice in mature economies, not so much in emerging economies. So, we are in the middle of a very deep and profound social and economic change, which has its origins in this technological revolution. It's unbelievable how progress has been moving in all kinds of applications of technology to our particular lives, but especially to this predictive factor of the world. And we will adapt, and we will have to adapt to it. But even if it is like this, and we must accept it, we also must accept that, as I said before, with this change, political powers have moved, have changed. So it's very interesting when some people from, I don't want to be aggressive, and I have very close relation with them, China. Is there anyone from China here? They come to you and they say, look, Juan, you're Europeans. Oh my God, we know what the hell are you going to do. It will take for you to take these decisions 1.5 years, 2 years, with this lady, the name is Merkel, and the other one, and taking the decisions. He said, I'm making it simpler, but it's like this. And we say, for us, this is not a problem. We know who is the minister. We know who is the vice minister, who is the vice minister. And you know what? Next year, there will be some changes. And we know that the new ladies and the new gentlemen that will come up to serve the state, the government, are these, and these are on the list. On this day. But no problem. If something happens to one of them, we have a substitute. So they have a system, a very agile system, take the decisions like this. And they do consider that how things are going on in Europe are a political issue, which is hampering recovery. And they are very much interested in having Europe perform. So it is not only economy, but it begins to be politics. And when it is politics, it begins to be the way our countries are managed. And when it comes to that, the conversation, which used to be the usual conversation some decades ago, which was that democracies, in the sense we understand democracies in the West, was the best system we have invented for the social progress of the countries and economic progress. Now, now they say, well, we don't think it is like this. Needless to say, I'm a European, so when I have this kind of conversation, I say, well, I want to be a European, not Chinese, not because I don't like Chinese, I love them, the country, their culture, but I much prefer to be European, which is something much more difficult in terms of managing the situation rather than being Chinese or being Indian or being another thing. And the big argument, which is you will come to our systems when your societies progress economically and socially demand another political system. But in the meantime, now we have this ideological positioning which can provoke serious problems in Europe, or perhaps in the United States, depending on how deep it gets into the beliefs of the citizens. And finally, in order to avoid more going into economics, the real estate bubble, which began in the United States, but which is in other countries like Spain in this particular moment, and the huge liquidity we have brought into the economy at this particular moment, both of them tell us that solutions are at hand. If you have a real estate bubble, that is something very easy to manage. If it is very big, it will take 10 years. If it is not very big, it will take 5 years, 3 years, 2 years. But always you know when you begin with the real estate bubble, and you know when you end. And the real estate bubble is ended when all this real estate comes upon the financial system, because the people, companies or individuals that have mortgages cannot pay for the mortgages. It comes upon the financial system. The financial system is not prepared to cope with the huge losses that come from the bubble. The financial system needs the application of public funds or not, depending on the system it's governing, in order to continue with their job, which is providing society with credit and preserving deposits. But 10 years later, there is no real estate bubble, offer and demand are neutralized, and then life continues in order to make the same stupid things in terms of real estate bubble 10 years or 15 years later. But it's always been there. Liquidity, we don't know. And we don't know. And this means that we don't know, and this is a much, much serious situation, because quantitative easing number one, quantitative easing number two, quantitative easing number three, quantitative easing at the UK, quasi-quantitative easing hands-free, you know, Europe, yes, European Central Bank in Europe. This is such an amount of money, which today is not moving. It's not going from one place to another. It's just invested with real, I would say, negative rates of interest in treasury bonds, etc., because there is no trust, there is no confidence. But in the very moment that this money, these trillions, is going to be moved, if we recover trust, this is something we don't know which effects will have. What we know now, because they have been brave in the United States to take position. It's a country that has been managing the situation with brave, sound, quick, and tough decisions. And this means that for the time being, success is very good. I will tell the Americans, you are. It took you 200 years to build up the country. With the Europeans, we have been doing it for the last 50 years, no more than 50 years. We will hurry. But the United States has done a very good job. Economy will grow next year better than this, all the expectations we have. And these are very good news for the world, India, China, etc. So, with all this liquidity, it looks like if this machine is in place. But if it accelerates, you will remember this, if it accelerates, then we will have to have too much longer. So, being this the scenario, I thought that it was much, much better to bring, as I have done on other occasions, to people like you, and all of you, you are professionals, you own your companies, you have day-to-day responsibilities, some more personal reflection, because what I said, you know, our chief economist, my chief economist never agrees with me, which makes me feel very, very comfortable. We have different opinions. Of course, he's supposed to be right, but it is nice to see how people can have different diagnoses on a situation like this, because it means that the situation is not clear. But there are some other things which are more personal, and if I may, if I dare to comment with you more personal issues, then I think friendship between you and me does, is much more enhanced, no? Because coming here to give you some figures on GDP, etc., etc., is not so personal. So, if I may, I have a first reflection, which I wish to highlight. And this first reflection I wish to highlight in this scenario, in this economic situation, is the relative importance of each of us. Very important, of course, very important. Especially important for oneself. Why not? That's nice. But we are very relative. People, individuals, are important. But so are the companies and institutions we create and develop together and upon we depend, as do our children and the future generation. So being important, I'm very much of the opinion that it is much, much more important what we create. And in terms of creation, we can create a work of art. I think that the companies you have developed and the institutions where you pretend for the future are fundamental. And this means that being as important as they are, generations who have the right to enjoy the values and social achievements that we have built have the right to demand to us to behave properly. So we are not alone. It is our creation. These are our companies. But immediately we have a link with future generations. We are not alone. So this means that companies give us the opportunity to exercise our talents with passion, which is another concept which is very interesting. Not so much passion going on in Europe today, but passion, this is a very Anglo-Saxon concept. I really like it. And we have to put passion on what we do, to enjoy the dignity of work. Not very fashionable, the dignity of work. To develop our legitimate creative ambition and to multiply our efforts thanks to the efforts of all other members. Needless to say. Of course we have a lot of problems and we put a lot of efforts into our company, but of course if we feel there are other people doing the same thing, this multiplies. Without talent and ambition, societies become paralyzed, comfortable. Because I always tell to my people, well, you know what you're explaining to me, it's easy going. Forget about it. There is nothing healthy for the next, I make jokes, in my company or in my country, for the next 2 years, which is easy. If you find an easy way, forget it. Everything which is healthy and builds up the future is going to be extremely difficult. And in this situation, everything will be done with pain, sacrifice, and a lot of work. So, this is it. And talent and ambition also can become counterproductive if they become a goal held over and above everything else. Of course, we need talent and ambition, but of course, there are some limits to our talent, which are human. There's not so much talent in everybody, but especially on ambition, which is prevented or encapsulated by the rules of the game. You must not break the rules of the game. So faced with the current economic crisis, I think that everyone is scrambling to offer severe savings ideas. Remedies of austerity and financial orthodoxy. And these remedies are indeed good criteria. but with savings and financial orthodoxy, we get to nowhere. Without a more profound change, there will be no effective change at all. So it's even more complicated than that. The diagnosis is what it is, and we know what we have to do, but only saving and reducing public deficit, etc., 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 we will not get out of the situation. To be effective, and this is the second idea, I want to share with you when we accept that we must recover in Europe. I'm talking in Europe. I wouldn't dare anything outside my country. No? We must recover the values that have helped us to build a better, freer, and fairer society. There are some values that have made up our societies, societies which are free and fair. And I am afraid this is something we have been spoiling during the last decades. We must work more and work better, and you are the best example of this, with no catches, in order to blend the general interest with the individualism of the institution. These times call for a change of ethical regimes to make sense of the technical measures and proposals. So we must give a step forward, being very conscious that added to all our technicalities, the ethical behavior in our companies and personally is much, much more needed. There's the third one, I'm finishing. Yes. And this is the third point upon I want to propose your comments. No? Which is that in order to do so, we need ethical leadership. Not all leaderships fit with a long-standing sustainable growth on the future. And this ethical leadership is based on the strengthening of the concept of us. An ethical leadership that should renew the cultural climate of our time and restore the internal values of each institution. Starting by defending the notion of group, of shared identity. Because in order to allow the creative values to flourish and the fair personal ambitions, of course we all have fair personal ambitions, we need to have a shared framework so that people can feel they form part of a broader, more valuable collective than the individual or the company sphere. If the company is very good and it's very, very big, okay, we can understand. But many, many times, we must allow our people with this ethical leadership to make them feel that they're part, an important part of the situation. And to do this, the first function is to provide security, restore the trust. When everyone is afraid that the future is in jeopardy, the first need is to put a stop to fear and restore trust through mutual support. This month of August, I had one month holiday, no? And there are 30,000 people in our group. Well, it's not one of the very big corporations, it's not that small, 30,000 people. And it is a bank, and we have 5,300 branches, so there are 20,000 people there. And I decided that in between September and December, I wanted to see the 5,300 branch managers. And everybody told me, look, that's not important. You have internet, internal communications, the newspaper of the company, everything. No? But I said, I need to look at the eyes to these people. And they said, what the hell are you going to tell them? I said, I don't mind. It's not that important. What do you want me to tell them? That we have a core capital which is the best in Spain, or liquidity the best, or we are performing quite nicely. This is not the message. The message is mistrust. No? So I have the meetings with the people. They prepare me perfect slides, you know, to make sure that as CEO of the group, I was going to say sound things. I've never gone into the slides. When I am with these people, I tell them, look, we must recover trust. And I want to talk to you. We are at the same place. So people in this crisis, and of course this applies specifically to Spain, which is in a difficult situation. Spain is one of the countries that realized 2-3 years ago that we were mismanaged in a difficult situation. Others have awakened today, not yesterday. But we are a society, we feel we are in a difficult situation. It is trust. No? Look, we are in the same place, this is the same company, I feel like you feel. Make sure that we restore trust. And this is ethical leadership. This is ethical leadership. Of course it is. But people, employees, people need to be with us. They look at us. They look at us as if we had some strange or bizarre capacity to know what the hell is going to happen. Or some kind of mysterious science which allows us to conduct the business and make sure that the companies will be a success or the country will be a success. It's not that much. But they need to trust us. And I like to talk to them. So this means believing for once and for all that we can only emerge from the most complex situations if we do it together. And we have a complex situation in our country. That the problem belongs to everyone and everyone needs to work more and better. And work more and better is another language which in Europe, and more specifically in Spain, and in some parts of our employees, or people that represent our employees, is not politically correct. They are not prepared to accept that we, Europeans or Spaniards, now we have to work more. What means more? Director, I say more, and they do not like it. And better, and better, and better. And this will be a change in Europe. Work more and better because other countries, other continents are teaching us. We must receive the example of these people, how working more and better we can build up a better society. And it will take time because it requires effort, work, and sacrifice, which are forgotten values, certain values we must regain if we want to see progress once again. We have lost a generation. Once again, just in Spain. All the generation, young people came up from the universities, everything was booming. All these people do not understand that in addition to supposed rights they have, they can demand to society, they also have obligations. And they do not want to know anything at all linked with effort, work, and sacrifice. Fortunately, now we have a new generation of people attending university will have tough times. They will have to immigrate, and this generation will be very, very good. And we must make sure that this new generation, in 3-4 years' time, we have these people coming to the work scene in Spain, will do the job. But it is tough language. And it's not accepted nowadays. And we will see in some European countries demonstrations, riots, everything, because they do not want to understand what we do. And where will all of this lead us? Those to obtaining outward credibility. We must regain trust. Our people must trust us, and we must regain outward credibility, reputation. Because the lack of credibility is the great disease of our time. We knew it before 2007, and we know it a little better. And we have seen the consequences. This very much links with the financial system on reputation and trust. So I will not make more comments on that, because I think you all know about it. We are experiencing complicated times as a result of this major crisis, which has to endure. But we do think, and very much convinced, that we have the strength of our values and principles and of the people like yourselves. And I come to the beginning when I said, when I come here and I stay with you, it's like 20 years of renewed energy in order to continue with my job. When I go out of this, I will see today, I think it's 15 one-on-ones, one every 45 minutes, and five of it at lunchtime, analysts and investors with some figures saying that the world is going to disappear. But it is their job, with their figures, and everything will be extremely negative. But when I come here, and I see you, things that you have done, the way you work, your values, what you're doing, everything, for me, it is life. Because you work, and you work with increasing sacrifice in your companies and projects. So, it is time, under my view, to restore the ethical leadership we were talking about and put it into practice. It is not only a question of ideas, to put it into practice. Because we must emerge from the crisis with the lesson well and truly learned, if we are to be sure that we do not commit the same mistakes again. So, my dear friends, ladies, thank you very much, and once again, my congratulations for the entrepreneurs winners, which will be awarded this afternoon. Thank you very much.
www.manhattancctv.com